When the United States ended World War II by dropping two nuclear bombs on Japan, the world was shocked by this new kind of weapon. The Soviet Union, our ally at the time, however, saw it as a threat, since we had developed the bomb under a blanket of secrecy. Hence, it was the beginning of a nuclear arms race, later labeled as the Cold War, that eventually resulted in a massive buildup of missiles equipped with atomic bombs in both the Soviet Union and the United States. And much of this arsenal was readily visible right here in our backyards in and around Bates County, Missouri. By the early 1960s, scattered in the 851 square miles of Bates County, there were some 20 missile silos under the control of two launch control facilities located in opposite corners of the county, one west of Passaic and one south of the Hudson School. These were manned 24/7 with personnel whose sole job was to push the launch button on a moment's notice. Time goes on, and during the 1970s, missiles were upgraded to carry three warheads that were about 60 times more powerful than either bomb dropped on Japan in 1945. Multiply that by 20 missiles in Bates County, plus some 80 more in western Missouri, and even more in at least five other states. The arms race was full on more than ever. While it continued to be a quiet standoff over the years, there were in fact five times during the Cold War a launch almost happened. It didn't, thanks to human intervention. So in the meantime, the silos stood in silence, scattered in cornfields and pastures, and seeing the secured, fenced, acre-sized facilities became a normal part of our lives. We lived with the fact that if a launch ever happened, it would be the end of life as we know it. Even though the silos and launch control facilities, known as LCFs, were visible, there was a degree of cloaking, an effort to make them appear like part of the landscape. For example, the LCFs look somewhat like an ordinary house, with the exception of all the blue Air Force vehicles and secure fencing all the way around. The silos were a little less conspicuous, a small fenced area in a field with not much showing above the ground. Each LCF was in charge of a flight of 10 missiles connected to the LCF by buried cable. There was a redundant cable connection to each silo in case the primary cable was cut. Later, an antenna was added at each unmanned silo so the missile could be launched by radio control. Security was way ahead of its time. The technology used was good enough to distinguish the difference between a bird and a person who might be too close to the fence. A lot of this technology was made public later, such as the motion detectors we now have in and around our homes. The above-ground side of the LCF was somewhat like a house. There was a kitchen, recreation area, bedrooms, bathrooms, and a dining area. There also was a security room, a generator, a well, and water treatment system, making the entire facility as self-contained as possible. Outside the LCF, there were a variety of radio antennas, ventilation ducts, a helicopter landing pad, fuel tanks, and more. Often you'd see Air Force personnel outside playing basketball, mowing, and doing other maintenance. Life above ground at the LCF was in stark contrast to life below, where two missileers stayed in shifts whose sole purpose was to validate a launch command and fly the missiles. Time spent below ground was contained to two main areas in two pods, accessible by an elevator many feet below the surface. The two pods contained the launch controls, basic living quarters, a generator, air conditioning equipment, and an escape hatch, if needed, that led to the surface. While the exact protocol is still classified, it is known that a very refined set of steps would have to be taken that included many safeguards in order to actually fire missiles. All LCFs had highly guarded information that included a code word tied with a date to ensure that there were no accidental firings. After a launch code was validated, it would take both missileers turning separate keys on a console within a quarter second of each other to actually fire the missiles. Likewise, it took the same action from an adjacent LCF so that no single LCF could initiate a launch sequence alone. After the codes were correctly sent to the silos, another computer within the silo validated all the information based on the date and launch code. The 4-ton silo door would be forced open, and within seconds, the 65,000-pound missile emerges, soon reaching 15,000 miles per hour and its destination anywhere around the world in 30 minutes or less. Fortunately, an actual launch never happened. So, our quiet way of life here in Bates County simply continued. At the peak of the Cold War, the U.S. had a stockpile of just over 30,000 nuclear warheads, while the Soviet Union had closer to 40,000. Then, Finally, a breakthrough in the mid-1980s. U.S.-Soviet relations significantly improved as Gorbachev assumed control of the Soviet Union and proposed a 50% reduction of nuclear weapons for both the U.S. and the Soviet Union. A treaty was finally signed between the two superpowers on December 8, 1987. Since then, the local silos and LCFs have been decommissioned by removing the equipment, imploding the silos, and filling them with concrete. Eventually, the property was sold to adjacent landowners. Some are now used to store hay and farm machinery. Likewise, much of the underground cable has been removed and sold for scrap. Take a drive today. Look around. Remnants of the great Cold War still remain, right here in our backyards in Bates County, Missouri.